Next month, it will have been 4 years since best friends Libby German and Abby Williams were brutally murdered while hiking the Monon High Bridge Trail in Delphi, Indiana. For some of us, the bridge has become a certain pilgrimage site. One that sees dozens flock to it to absorb where all of this went down. Delphi has become a battered ghost town, trapped in time. Wanted posters now fill the empty storefront windows with his image. The image of this man, videoed as he walks towards them, ready to march them to their own deaths. Libby, using her phone's video feature, left law enforcement with a video of their killer, heralding her a hero for having the presence of mind to do so. In 2020, Libby's mother, Carrie Timmons, came out to Inside Edition, kicking a low blow at Carroll County Sheriff Tobe Lesenby, the head investigator assigned to the case in Carroll County. Timmons is upset at the way the case has been conducted since the very beginning, and with good reason. At 1:45 p.m. on February 13, 2017, the girls were dropped off at Mears Lot at the Monon High Bridge Trail. They would have entered the trail intersection and walked across the bridge. Altogether, it would have taken the girls approximately 40 minutes to reach the southeast side of the bridge, where they were soon abducted by the man captured on Libby's phone. It is rumored that police believe the whole crime lasted no more than 40 to 50 minutes, and that by 3:30 p.m., the girls were murdered and the murderer escaped. At 3:11 p.m., Derek calls Libby's phone to let her know that he's nearby. He is at that moment crossing Wilson's Bridge. He arrives at Mears Lot at 3:13. After several calls and texts, he exits his vehicle to search. He enters the trail, speaks with Dave McCain, walking around the trail intersection. After a while, he becomes concerned, and he contacts Becky Patty and his sister Tara at approximately 3:30 p.m. Both Becky and Tara begin texting and calling Libby. At 4 p.m., Becky, Tara, Derek, and Cody search the trails together. Mike Patty, Becky's husband, shows up around 4:30. At 4:45, after calling in sick for work, Kelsey shows up at the lot. At 5 o'clock p.m., Mike Patty texts his police department friend. Between 5:05 and 5:30, county deputies began to arrive on scene. Over the course of the hour, Facebook begins to see posts from family and concerned locals. Family friends begin to arrive at the bridge to help them search. The Carroll County Sheriff's Department takes lead with only 11 officers on the force, and local PD is assisting where they can. At approximately 5:45 p.m., Carroll County Sheriff Tobe Lesenby gets local citizen Joel Wagner to contact Mike Butram, a local drone operator from the area. Lesenby and Butram go to a property near the bridge. The drone was set up with a FLIR thermal camera. He flew the drone very high from two locations, circling the entirety of the bridge trail system on Deer Creek. Though he sees people searching deer and wildlife, he does not spot the girls. Now, there are some who believe that a FLIR system wouldn't have picked up the bodies of the girls on Logan's property because they possibly came in contact with the cold environment, were partially nude, or may have been wet. These are good arguments, but I don't think they explain it. You see, a body cools after death, and yes, the environment would have surely sped that up, but not that fast. The drone was flying no later than 6 to 6:30 p.m. Mr. Butram says he was at the sheriff's office at dusk. Sunset on that night was 6:20 p.m. So if we were to believe that the murders occurred where the girls were inevitably found, and that they were already deceased by 3:30 p.m., that would put the time of death only 3 to 4 hours earlier. Under normal circumstances, it would take the human body up to 20 hours to reach ambient or room temperature. Remember, the human body is 98.6 degrees Fahrenheit on average, and the historical data puts the outdoor temperature at 35 to 40 degrees Fahrenheit. If the bodies were there, they would have showed up. Okay, so the bodies were 40 to 50 feet back from the creek. Might they have missed them? I guess so. I do find it hard to believe that given the drone flew approximately 200 feet up, that it wouldn't have spotted the girls had they looked in that area. The area was a circular clearing with less dense foliage. We saw it on the news helicopter. But I guess anything's possible. That, however, does not explain the countless witnesses and searchers who claim to have searched that very spot and did not see the girls' bodies that night. So almost directly after the drone operator left, Tobe Lesenby told the group that he would like to postpone the search until the morning. A very controversial decision. He has given several excuses for why he did this. The first excuse is that he claims that the dangerous terrain would have been too much for people to handle in the dark. That's a legit concern. But if my daughters were lost out in the woods, potentially injured or abducted, and the law told me they were not going to help me out because it was too dark, I would be very upset with that. The second excuse, which is really ridiculous, was the excuse that searchers were tired and needed rest or some dumb shit. Like, seriously, what the hell's wrong with this guy? His third reason is that the girls were likely in town, gallivanting around, and that Libby has done this before in the past. Well, nope. Sorry, Pinocchio. Becky says that Libby would never have done this. And he knows that. What a bad excuse. Now, Mr. Lesenby has gotten a ton of flack for calling off the search. And lately, he's tried to claim that in spite of calling off the search, that many stayed and searched anyways. Yeah. The family stayed. Well, all of Tobe's paid officers abandoned the scene and announced that they would help search in the fucking morning. I've been very hard on the Patties, but they deserve an award for having to deal with this crap. These girls might very well have been saved had he just done his damn job. But apparently canine units were called in from Illinois due to canine officers not being available in the area. It would have taken them approximately 12 hours to show up. Another terrible choice.
But to better understand his real misses, we're going to have to examine Indiana law.
Indiana state law makes it very clear when it defines the difference between a missing person and what it considers a high-risk missing person. When reading the criteria for this, it becomes clear that several aspects cover the girls and their disappearance. Once one or more of the criteria were met, it should have caused an activation of policy that began the investigation into the disappearance of the girls. But for whatever reason, it didn't, and unfortunately, it wasn't taken seriously for almost 12 hours. Enough time for their abductor to potentially escape, for the crime scene to get so expansive that it couldn't be covered, and enough time that any hope that one of the girls lived was gone. The taxpayers, and especially the victims, were let down that day by Carroll County. The key to this lackluster investigation lies in its leader. He sure made it difficult for himself and his friends to move forward in this case, and this has to start with the search on February 13th. Let's take a look at the sheriff's peculiar actions on February 13th, 2017. He did not enter the missing persons info into the IDAC system for missing persons until the next day. He turned down local canine search dogs, claimed that canines were coming from Illinois and/or Kentucky.
My team attempted to look for records about the canines and the requests, but were unable to stumble on any records.
He lied several times to the media, claiming that he didn't believe the girls were in any imminent danger, while also admitting that the environment is their greatest threat. Keep in mind that it was 32 degrees Fahrenheit that night, and neither girl were dressed properly. Among his many white lies that he fed to the news to deflect blame, he stated that the girls had ran away several times before. The family has confirmed that this is totally untrue. He failed to secure the scene or contact any neighboring law enforcement about the missing persons case. Each and every one of these points contributed to the case now becoming cold. These girls deserve better, and only you can help the families by holding Tobe Lesenby and Carroll County accountable for the things that they've done. Fear may stop local detractors from scrutinizing these bullies from controlling the outcome of this case, but their biggest mistake was making this case go viral. The social media presence has ensured that these questions about integrity continue to be asked until we're given the truth. It's taken 4 years for Carroll County to even start to get all shook up. So many resignations, many by high-ranking officials. It seems that even some of these guys have a bit of a conscience. At the end of 2016, a house fire claimed the lives of 4 children and nearly their mother in Flora, Indiana. Initially, the fire was deemed not suspicious by fire investigators and canine. No accelerants were ever found. Months later, however, Carroll County Fire Investigator Dennis Randall, in this role for 13 years at the time, opened an investigation into the arson homicide. In the forums, suddenly claimed that in fact accelerants were indeed found in the house and in multiple areas. It was later determined in review that Randall was not only incorrect about these findings, but also that he outright lied about them. Why would he do this? Because of his son's connection to the landlord. And because the Auditor General had just months earlier began investigating the paperwork inquiry into the victim's mother in regards to insurance for the landlord. This led to Dennis Randall's resignation as fire investigator and, ultimately, the resignation of his son, Flora Fire Chief Adam Randall. Interestingly, around the same time, Randall's ex-wife, Jean Ann, was caught stealing cash from the clients of the law firm that she worked for. The funds ended up totaling over $20,000. She got a mere 36 months of probation for this
and gave an empty promise to pay it back.
Finally, as the investigation ramped up concerning Randall's work, prosecutor Robert Ives also stepped down for allowing the good old boys to get away with this. Four years is a long time to live without a single answer, and the victims' families, they've waited long enough. We must stand behind the notion that truth is better than silence, that compassion supersedes this type of economic vampirism. I encourage any of my viewers who are from Indiana and may have knowledge of any state or county government officials or law enforcement that are involved in public corruption crimes, please contact your state and federal investigative agencies to file a complaint. To the families of the victims, I and so many others want to see this through with you, and we will. Join me in a couple weeks as we discuss and establish a profile of the killer or killers. We'll break down every single person of interest that this case has had up to this point, from Daniel Nations to Gabe Ellis. We will try to break down some of the most plausible theories, and we'll discuss possible signatures left by the killer at the crime scene. Make sure each of you like, share, and subscribe, and stay safe out there in this crazy-ass world.